This is the Yukon, northwesternmost province of Canada. It is, for the most part, a vast wilderness covering over 207,000 square miles, and is one of the few large game areas left on our continent. Across its autumn-covered hills, sun-flecked rivers, a pack train winds its way. The hunters are now about 100 miles northwest of Whitehorse, which is on the Alcan Highway, and are nearing a remote area where they hope to hunt mountain goats and perhaps grizzly bear with a bow and arrow. After long days in the saddle, the party at last reaches base camp, set up in advance by the outfitter, and soon the routine chores of camp life take over. A worn horseshoe is deftly replaced, and the horses, free at last from their heavy packs, indulge in a refreshing dust bath. Members of the party, too, clean up, and a battery-powered shaver is given a trial run. An interested onlooker is the Parker Squirrel. A neighbor is more interested in stuffing his commodious cheek pouches with a free handout. Warming up muscles stiffened by the ride is necessary. The bowman is Fred Bear, who has come to test his chosen weapon in this beautiful game land. The first spot worthy of investigation is a small, swift stream near camp. For this is the time of year when some of the Pacific salmon are completing their spawning run. To get this far, these powerful fish may have traveled up the mighty silt-laden Yukon River from its outpouring in the Bering Sea, some 1,500 miles across Alaska, and another 700 or 800 miles into this Yukon wilderness to reach the very stream in which they were born some 5 to 7 years ago. An incredible voyage, and the last one of their lives, for they die soon after spawning. The archer soon has his bow rigged with a reel and a harpoon-pointed fiberglass arrow, and proceeds to search for a target in a gravel stream. His shot connects, and immediately he has his hands full as the salmon gyrates downstream, aided by the swift current. The bow fisherman is using a 70-pound test line, and it's strained almost to the limit in the ensuing tug of war. Finally, however, the spent fish gives up the struggle and is landed. Hook-jawed, starred, and red in color, he little resembles his former silvery, streamlined appearance. One such battle is enough, for these spawned-out fish are useless as table fare. Back in camp, they're ready with the cutting arrows for the bigger game ahead. First, carefully filing the main blade of the broadhead, working toward the point for safety's sake. A razor-thin auxiliary blade of finely honed steel is then fitted into a slot in the ferrule. The result is a 4S blade with extra cutting surface. These razor heads were developed by Fred Bear for hunting big game. Early the following morning, two pack horses are expertly loaded with enough gear to establish a side camp. Now, these fellows make the necessary balancing and securing of the loads look easy, but it is the result of long practice. Soon after, Bear and his outfitter guide, Alex Van Bibber, set out to find game. In traveling this country, much brush can be avoided by following the river eddies. These rivers are, for the most part, fairly shallow and have a gravelly bottom on which the horses can find footing. stone across the swift current. Fred Rugged's Kodiak bow of fiberglass laminated to hard maple does double duty as a waiting staff. A swift here would mean a most uncomfortable bath, for these glacial fed waters are icy cold.
Out a fat marmot and
Professor Bowman hit Janice. The white chap leaves his foe in a blur, and what happens then is almost too fast for the eye to follow. Now, repeating this exciting sequence in freeze frame, we can observe the action in more detail. The pointer follows the arrow on its way to the bear. As the bowman releases his shaft, the grizzly's head and shoulders are in the excavation he has started. The instant before the arrow reaches him, he hears the hum of the bowstring. Too late, for the razor head slices completely through him and into the hillside beyond. The silver tip swings around to bite his side where the arrow hit. He swings back and takes off in flight. Reaching the top of the knoll, he slackens his stride momentarily for a quick backward glance and then shifts into a high gear. The speed with which these big bears move is phenomenal, and this fellow covers 80 yards in less time than could a racehorse. That's about as far as he will go, however, for the glass-powered bow and deadly razor head have done their work well. Fred races up to examine the fallen monarch. Of all the hunts he has made, this one furnished the biggest thrill. Appropriately enough, the great bear is his 50th game trophy taken with the bow and arrow. Once abundant, the grizzly has been driven from much of his original domain by the inroads of civilization. It is to be hoped that through continued conservational measures, these magnificent animals will always find sanctuary in the Yukon wilderness.